Good morning.
Good morning.
A warm welcome to all of you who are worshiping together in Avonmore Park in Edmonton, a few blocks south of Spirit of Hope United Church, and to those of you who are watching later on YouTube. My name is Karen Astrope, and I'm a member of the M&P Mitty at this church. When we're meeting outside, it is perhaps even more meaningful that we acknowledge the land on which we gather. We acknowledge with respect the history, spirituality, and cultures of the people of Treaty 6 and the territory on which we gather today. We honor the heritage and gifts of Métis people. We recognize our responsibilities as treaty members, and we are grateful. This is an enduring promise. In the words of Alexander Morris, Commissioner of Treaty 6, "For as long as the sun shines, the grass grows, and the river flows." Are there any announcements today other than what's in the Spark? Okay, this is the time for that.
I just wanted to let people know a notice that we received this week, and we'll put it in the Spark next week. But the city is going to be doing what they call micrograding on the roads, which means they'll be putting some new paving on the roads, the side roads in front of the church and around the side. And they'll be starting this week. And so sometime you will see no parking signs on the street, which means you need to park in the parking lot. And we do have some parking spots along the back, but we're also having the roofing work done. So that might not be a good place to park. So I'm hoping that it will work out where we can all park just in the parking lot. And you can park there until you see the signs, but when you see the signs, please do obey them. So thank you.
Oh, good morning. And gathered literally in the light of this day, take a moment to greet each other, to share words of good morning and welcome, and let's come together as we worship God today.
Morning, everybody.
Well, it starts on Monday, but yes, that should be a problem.
Morning has broken, like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken, like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning. Praise for them springing fresh from the word. Let's pray together. O God, may all of creation be our sanctuary. May we recognize the daily cosmic events above us and around us and beneath us every minute of our lives, and sky and the oceans, the earth and under the earth, as visible symbols of the earth and grace. Amen. Morning has broken. First morning.
This morning's reading is from Mark chapter 6, verses 30 to 34 and 53 to 56. The apostles came back to Jesus and reported all that they had done and taught. Jesus said to them, "Come away by yourselves to some place more remote and rest a while." For there were many people coming and going, and the apostles hadn't had time to eat. So they went away in a boat to a deserted area. The people saw them leaving, and many recognized them. So they ran together on foot from all the cities and got there ahead of the apostles. When Jesus went ashore, there was a large crowd waiting for him. And he felt compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. After crossing the lake, Jesus and the disciples came ashore at Gennesaret and tied up their boat there. No sooner had they stepped out of the boat than people recognized Jesus. The crowds started hurrying about the countryside and brought the sick on stretchers wherever Jesus went. Wherever he appeared, in villages, in towns, or in the countryside, they laid down the sick in the open places, begging him to let them touch just the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched Jesus got well.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we are grateful for the newness of this day, the tradition of our scripture, and the constant presence of your Spirit. Amen. It's a sad song. It's a sad tale. It's a tragedy. It's a sad song, but we'll sing it anyway. Because here's the thing, to know how it ends and still begin to sing again. And we're gonna sing it again and again and again. I did something this morning that I almost never do. I set my phone to the do not disturb mode. That's exceedingly rare for me. I am absolutely horrible at unplugging. I did that this morning though, because like last week, I'm using my phone to record our church service today. And I want to make sure that if someone tries to call me or text me over the next 45 to 60 minutes, that the sound of that won't end up on our YouTube channel a little later this afternoon. I absolutely love the access and the convenience of having a mini computer and communication nexus in my pocket. But I recognize that it costs me. And I don't just mean the money that Rogers takes out of my account every month. It costs me the ability to really take a break. Well, some of you know that I'm going to be taking a week of holidays starting tomorrow. In fact, I hope to be 3,700 kilometers away from here by tomorrow afternoon. Wow, the standby loads don't look great, but I'm going to get there. But with that little rectangle in my pocket, how far away will I really be? Now, I've set up my church email to send out an auto response email and the voicemail on the office phone that will tell people about my vacation time. That covers kind of my main ministry work at the church, but it doesn't stop information I might get about my wider church work, because you see, a few years back, I changed all of my contact information for any wider church work that I was doing from my church office phone and email address to my personal cell phone and email. And I did that for, I think, two very reasonable reasons. One, the nature of the wider church work that I often do means that the topics are often highly confidential. And I figured that I could keep confidentiality a bit better if I kept it off my church computer. And two, at the time, I was approaching nearly two decades of ministry in the church that I was at the time. And I knew I wouldn't be there forever. Either I would move or I would retire. And I didn't want to burden the next future minister with getting irrelevant and potentially confidential information. And so this meant that when I did change churches 4.5 years ago, I didn't have to change any of my contact information with the region. The reality is that we have evolved into an instant gratification society. We are a drive-through, have it ready when I want it culture. And we expect very quick responses. I remember hearing a comedian on late night talk show several years ago mocking our use of cell phones. You know, kind of looking down at the phone going, it won't, give it a second. It's going to space. You know, can you wait for it to come back from space? Is the speed of light not fast enough for you? We are not a very patient species anymore. Dare I say, some of us act pretty entitled. In fact, my spouse would tell you that she encounters that attitude several times a day when working at the airport if something doesn't go quite right. Fortunately, she's got a week of holidays coming up as well. Having said that, I really can't bemoan anyone for calling or emailing me or leaving me a message when I'm on a break. The person that I have a problem with is me. Leaving a message is not the problem. Responding to every message like it's the most urgent thing in the world is. Because I'm the one who's probably going to check my messages anyway over the next week. I think I project onto myself a sense of desperation that people might feel needing to hear something right away, even for non-urgent issues. And after all, it's only going to take me a minute. But those minutes add up. And we know that rest and rejuvenation is necessary for anyone to be able to function effectively and healthily, but there is huge pressure from within and without to avoid rest. Some of the most busy people that I've ever encountered in my life are people who claim to be retired. Our culture, in practice, teaches us that our personal needs are less valuable than another need. and that hard work is really defined as only work. Unless you're on the very edge of a breakdown, the pressure is there to just avoid rest when you can. We tell ourselves, I can handle it. And we can, until our bodies and our minds won't let us. And then, when we do have the breakdown, the culture will say, well, they should have looked after themselves better. You know, self-care is important. It's a sad song, but it's actually older than we might think. This isn't something that begins with technology in our pocket. It's been sung again and again and again. The Bible is big on Sabbath, on a regular rest. The Torah required a 7-year cycle for land use. The Torah spoke of a 7 times 7 years for financial and subservient resets, where debts were forgiven and slaves were freed, in theory at least, because there's no biblical record of a literal jubilee in the 50th year ever actually happening. But most commonly, Sabbath rest was honored weekly, allowing time to focus on God. But a side lesson that everybody learned from honoring that Sabbath day week by week was, you figured out that, you know, almost all of the normal labors of life could actually afford to take a day off. The world didn't stop turning because of the Sabbath. So you'd think that the Bible would offer us good justification to take a real regular rest where my need might trump other needs. You know, we might ask ourselves, what would Jesus do? Okay? Actually, a bad question to ask today. Because as we heard in the Bible reading, Jesus and his disciples planned on taking a break. The disciples had just returned from their 2x2 mission trips, and they'd sat together and they'd shared their experiences with each other and with Jesus, and they'd earned a break. And so Jesus suggested that they intentionally travel to another part of the lake away from the large crowd. But the crowd followed them. And the crowd arrived before they did. And when Jesus got to that new place, he abandoned his rest plan and went right back to work. You may have noticed that there were some verses missing from today's lectionary reading. In Mark chapter 6, you may have noticed that we jumped right from the end of verse 34 to the beginning of verse 53. And there's two main reasons, I think, why there's two things that we missed hearing in those missing verses. One, there's the story of Jesus feeding a crowd of more than 5,000 people, even though an initial taking of the inventory of the food they had available said they only had 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. This was actually the crowd that snuck around the lake and got there before Jesus did. The other story is that when the disciples without Jesus this time are out on the lake in their boat, they're struggling against a choppy sea, heavy winds, and Jesus comes walking out on the water to join them, and the winds calm down and they can sail more safely. This was actually a second boat trip in the bigger story that eventually led them to a different large crowd that would surround them at Gennesaret on the other side of the lake, that last few verses we heard today. And I can add that the reason why Jesus wasn't in the boat when the storm came up was because after feeding the 5,000 and dismissing that crowd, Jesus went up on a mountain to pray by himself. He didn't get his break earlier. He was going to take it now. It's from his hilltop vantage point overlooking the lake that he sees his disciples struggling with their oars. And so again, work interrupts Jesus' time of rest and rejuvenation. Now, I completely accept the compilers of the lectionary choosing to compact that narrative. And not giving us the entire 54 or 58 verses. Because even without the details of those middle stories, we still get the message. that Jesus has compassion for the needs of others. They're like a sheep without a shepherd, as the text says. And that Jesus is so committed to the ministry that when the ministry has needs, Jesus will fill them. But the unintended spin of this theme is that a planned time of rest should always be interrupted because the work is not supposed to wait. And that is certainly true sometimes. There are emergencies and there are times of literal life and death that shouldn't wait or can't wait. And there are times when we choose to break up a rest for a moment of something, but in this work yourself into your grave culture, that is often not the case, and yet we follow that pattern. Jesus' level of commitment is supposed to be inspiring, and it is. But in a way, it's a sad song, and it sends a message that rest and rejuvenation is only allowed to exist after all of the work is done. And so, church leaders, pastors, ministers, people in church are always saying, what are we supposed to be doing next? We can't sit back and do nothing. We have to fill every second of the calendar. We have to have something going on all the time. Now, I'm being a little hard on Jesus, because Jesus did seek out the rest. And Jesus encouraged his followers to reflect on their experiences in their quiet moments together. They had their debriefing session and Jesus said, hey, let's go someplace quiet. What I lament is that we have come to forget the biblical value of Sabbath. It's viewed as a luxury, not a necessity. We are beings who are created to need constant refueling, physically and mentally. And I would add spiritually as well, because we tell the stories again and again, both to be reminded, but also to hear new things in old words. And like the world that we evolved into, most of our physical bodies are made of water. It's literally the medium of our existence. It's this moisture that takes nutrients to our most distant cells. It allows actually this moisture for us, our physical flexibility. We wouldn't be able to move if it wasn't for moisture. It gives us that ability to explore and discover. And like the world that we evolved into, the water of our body is constantly cycling. It's evaporating to keep us cool. It's used to expel what we don't need. And so we need to constantly be replenishing the stores regularly. Our bodies need food. Food, the carrier of energy and the building blocks of growth. And we are made to slow down for a significant part of the day. The pattern of cosmic light and dark evolved habits for our ancestors of sleeping at night when our minds would be allowed to wander beyond our experiences while our bodies reset. Our natural need is to follow this constant cycle of nourishment and reset, and it provides us with regular opportunities to claim Sabbath. Even if our past pattern has been to avoid rest, a new opportunity comes around again and again and again, and we can take the next rest as it comes, even if the last rest wasn't available. Drinking and eating and resting are essential to who we are. It was on the Thursday of Jesus' final Passover visit to Jerusalem that Jesus modeled all of these three, eating, drinking, and resting, in what we might describe as Jesus' final lived-out parables. Jesus' followers had joined him on this pilgrimage, and they shared the evening meal together. One bread, one body, as you are united in eating, remember me. One vine, one cup, as you drink, you are united. Remember me. And after supper, Jesus and his three closest disciples retreated to the garden to pray, to reflect, to discern. Today we gather with them at table and in the garden, like we've done again and again and again. Let's pray. Holy God, grain transformed, full of nutrients. Holy God, fruit ripened, full of moisture. May these elements of communion feed both body and soul. And we pray God Jesus' family prayer in the style passed on to us in the book of Luke. Creator, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. For we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to a time of trial. Amen. Gluten-free bread and unprocessed wine. I invite each of us, whether we are new or old to this experience, whether we are sure of where we feel or uncertain, let us eat and drink and reflect to our spiritual nourishment. Amen. Of the Spirit, make me whole. Bread of life, feed my heart with the grace and mercy you impart. I have heard your voice calling. Come, my friend, and share in the feast that is laid out for you, to show how much I care. Bread of life, aim I live a life as pure and true as Jesus did. Bread of life, help me see the boundless love of Christ for you and me. I have heard your voice calling. Come, my friend, and share in the feast that is laid out for you, to show how much I care. Bread of life, feed my soul. If there is anyone who has brought offerings for the life and work of the church today, there is a box kind of in the center there where all the bulletins are that people can leave that if they like. But let's hear a bit of the story of the impact of our giving on the world that we live in.
The moment for mission today is entitled Restoring Lost Languages. These days, most of us have access to technology that allows us to learn the world's common languages. But countless languages, including many indigenous languages, can only be learned from their few remaining speakers. Revitalizing a lost language, as one of our partners in Nunavut is doing, is an important way to preserve not just the language, but also the culture that surrounds it. The Inuinakten language is the cultural foundation of the Inuinat people who live in the central Canadian Arctic. The literal meaning of the word Inuinakten is to be like an Inuak, a person. Today, fewer than 600 people can still speak Inuinakten fluently. Many lost the language when they were removed from their communities and sent to residential schools. Pitkernikit Ilotinik Kitimiot Heritage Society in Cambridge Bay, Nunavut, is working hard to keep Inuinakten alive. One-on-one language immersion sessions with mentors inspire reconnection. Through everyday conversations at home and on the land, mentorship is helping to heal the wounds of systemic oppression. In partnership with Mission and Service, Inuinakten language mentors get resources to allow them to spend 300 hours a year working with their apprentices to begin to restore the language. Your gifts to Mission and Service help partners continue to restore language and culture. Thank you.
Every day is a day of thanksgiving. God, you've been so good to me. Every day you're blessing me. Now every day is a day of thanksgiving. I will glorify you, oh my Lord, today. Pray. God of abundance, teach us to give, to share, to offer ourselves for your work in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm gonna live so. as we go from this place, go into your times of living God's life, a life of work and rest, a life of purpose and nothingness. Go in peace to be rejuvenated and reset, and always in the presence of God's Spirit. Amen.
Amen.